us pray. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Genesis, chapter 18, beginning at the first verse. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, and you may refresh yourselves. And after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant, who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared, and he set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There, in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old, and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said, "God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me." And she said, "Who would have ever said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." Here ends the reading.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at the 35th verse. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment. Give without payment. Here ends the reading. In the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I love the Old Testament story we heard today about Sarah laughing. When I think of faithfulness and examples of faithfulness from Scripture, Abraham and Sarah always are at the very top of my list. You know, they started out as Abram and Sarai. And when they came to know the Lord and the covenant that they made with the Lord, they got new names, Abraham and Sarah. And they did all that the Lord asked of them, well into their old age, right? Today's passage we heard, they're old. Sarah has gone the way of women, it says. She can no longer bear children. They're old. And yet they have some visitors that prophesy that the next time one of them comes to see them, Sarah will have a son. And they wanted children for forever. The Lord promised that their descendants would number the stars in the sky and the grains of sand on the beach. And they had no children. And so, but they were faithful. They were faithful. And so these strangers, these visitors come, and I have an icon of this particular passage in my office that's just beautiful and breathtaking. The three visitors and Abraham and Sarah with them eating under this tree, the oaks of Mamre, and they say, you're going to have a son next time one of us comes to see you. And Sarah in the tent overhears, and she laughs. She laughs. And they hear her and they say, why are you laughing? This is true. I didn't laugh. And he says, yes, you did laugh. I love that story. One, because I really truly believe that laughter is holy. Laughter is holy in many ways. I feel that so strongly that I co-authored a book about preaching and humor and laughter, and that I'm certain that God laughs, absolutely certain, and not in a vindictive way, but in a kind of a just beautiful, life-giving way, right? Have you ever just like fallen to the ground in a bout of laughter? Can you remember the euphoria that exists after that? How great you feel, how released and relaxed and content you feel after a really good belly laugh. So I believe laughter is holy, right? But what I love about this passage is that it says even so much more than that. And what I want to focus on today is emotional reaction. Emotional reaction. Because here's what I see happening a lot right now in my context, all over my social media and in conversations with my extended family and my friends. There's a lot going on right now that creates a knee-jerk reaction in us. And that's an emotional reaction, right? There's such a thing as pandemic fatigue, right? We're all feeling it. Whether you get to go out of the house and go to your office, or you're stuck at home, or you've had so much worry in the last 3 months about financial security that you're pulling your hair out and you're not sleeping at night, and we're all fatigued. We're forgetting to wash our hands and wear our masks. And sometimes I forget to like eat lunch. You know, I'm just like in a fog sometimes, and that's real. So I want to honor that. But I also think that in that state, our emotions are right below the surface. They're very close. And so things that are strongly stated elicit in us an emotional reaction. And it could be that we find whatever was said or offered on the news or on our social media feed or in conversation with our families, whatever is said seems impossible, right? Like in Sarah's case, she's like, I can't have a kid. I'm too old, right? Like there's literally no physiological way for me to birth a child. Maybe it seems impossible. Or maybe it goes against every value that you hold dear, right? Whatever it is, we are reacting emotionally right off the bat with anger or with an eruption of cheers and support and like, yeah, get it! Or like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard, right? And we're seeing it play out on a national scale, right? Our landscape is full of really strong emotional reactions. But then Sarah does something really, I think, really human. And I think it's something we all do, and I want to get really honest about it. When she gets confronted about her emotional reaction, she's like, no, I didn't laugh. Because she was scared of the social consequences of what people would think. Oh, I didn't laugh. No, I would never do such a thing. Friends, whatever your reactions have been to the myriad news stories lately, the conversations you're having, the upsets, the victories, whatever it is, I want you to think about why you're reacting that way, what that first emotional reaction is, and why you feel that way. What is it that is the foundation of that? Is it a value that feels affirmed or negated? Is it a threat to financial or social security for you and your family? Is it that change is hard? What, examine in yourself what it is you are reacting to and for. And then, instead of falling into our humanity like Sarah does, and I want you to own it. You know what? I got really upset. And I know that anger is right under the surface for me right now, and I'm sorry about that. This is why I'm angry. Because I feel like my autonomy was taken away from me or wasn't respected. Or I'm really excited because this work is really important to me and I hate seeing injustice, and I recognize that there's a long way to go, but this small moment in time feels good to me. And I'm happy to tell you why and bring you along with me. Whatever it is, anger, joy, sadness, pick an emotion. Whatever your reaction is, own it. Explore it and own it in a way that is honest and authentic and can lead to more conversation with those around you instead of shutting everyone down. We need to listen to each other. Like our gospel says, we need to love compassion. We need to love compassion and mercy. Those are the wellsprings of life right now in a time of discord and tension and fear of us and them. So figure out your emotions. Laughter, crying, yelling, whatever it is. But learn from Sarah who indeed had a son. And that son had two sons. And on and on until the ancestors of Abraham and Sarah came here, founded St. Mark's. Right? Even the impossible is possible. But we have to be willing to dig deep, to really own our own part of the story, to try to understand other people's parts, to come together as one Christian family. Amen.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for the Archbishop of Canterbury, our presiding bishops, our bishops, our clergy, and all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for our president, our Congress, our governor, our state legislators, our mayors, city councils, judges, county officials, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. We pray especially for our school, our headmaster, the faculty, administrators, and staff, for our church staff and musicians and our sextons, for our vestry, our church committees, and our school board. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest. Let light perpetually shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. We pray for all those who serve in the armed forces. May they be guided and protected by your love. Let us pray for our own needs and for those of others.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, send your Holy Spirit into our hearts to direct and rule us according to your will, to comfort us in all our afflictions, to defend us from all error, and to lead us into all truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Here I find.